Hello, Lab Zero fans. This is Shadow Fury 333 with a game that's, well, a prototype, as you can see from the title. This is a game from the developers of Skullgirls, Lab Zero Games, and it is on Indiegogo. They're currently getting all the funding for it. They just started the campaign this Monday, and I wanted to do a stream of it because their prototype is really fun, and it's also quite refreshing to have a funding, like Kickstarter, Indiegogo-style crowdfunding campaign start with a playable prototype. I was actually under the impression that, mistaken impression, that this was mandatory now. I thought that you were supposed to have that because there was a bunch of issues with Broken Age and to a lesser extent with Planetary Annihilation and definitely to a greater extent with Mighty No. 9, although admittedly the playable demo for that does exist and that's a different story. Rather frustrating game, that one. But anyway, the point is, this has a prototype that's free for everyone. You don't have to pay for anything at all. You have to throw anything into the pot for Indiegogo. You can just play the game, well, the prototype what they have now, and see what it's like. And I'm going to do that right now, since streaming games is a very popular thing. So I might as well show you guys the game, and we'll begin now. So this game, as you might be able to tell, although it's a little bit tricky, the art's somewhat abstract at this point, is a little unusual in its setting.
Wait.
It takes place in somewhere in Southeast Asia. I'm not sure it's meant to be Indonesia or India or what exactly. It's vaguely Hindi. At any rate, that is what we're starting with. So everything here is based more or less on, I believe, Hindu mythology primarily. And the main character here, Ajna, which she's called, which is apparently the name of the third eye chakra. Something I'm not super familiar with myself. I'm not much of one for mysticism. I'm sadly undereducated in Southeast Asian mythology. But yes, apparently that is what her name signifies. It is, if you go watch the prototype, they have a campaign video that shows that she's got this. She does have sort of magic powers related to third eye stuff. They aren't super clear about the details yet. The upshot of it is that over time, as I beat enemies in the prototype, it'll be a bit more subtle in the main game, but in the prototype, as I beat enemies, I get essentially ghosts called incarnations that I get to use. I believe they're supposed to be her past lives. At any rate, that's how it'll work out lore-wise. Now, combat-wise, this game borrows a lot from an old PlayStation game that I've actually never played called Valkyrie Profile, which does look pretty interesting, though. Though, adapting to fighting games somewhat, or fighting game mechanics somewhat, basically, I get to hit any button for characters. At this point, I only have the one, but once I get more characters, it'll become more clear. But when I hit a button, like, I can attack in the, essentially, Metroid view. But depending on what kind of attack I do, that was actually a bad idea. But depending on the attack I do, I get, well, the direction, as you can see, there's by the B2 thing, the up and down, depending on what direction I choose, that determines what attack I choose. Each attack is different. I can be either neutral or down, which I saw before, or up, which I will do right now. Typically, neutral seems to deal a bit more damage. Down is usually the quickest, and up is usually an area attack. Hits a bunch of enemies. The way that attacking works is actually based off of hitboxes. It borrows a lot from fighting games that way. It's pretty straightforward, actually. It's not based on anything too arbitrary. And as you can see, now that I have, come on, okay. Now that I have a party member, I can actually control them as if they were a different character with their own moves. Now, timing is actually really important. It's a little hard to tell because I'm trying to be pretty conservative about how I use my moves. I could be mashing out if I wanted to. Like, if I wanted to, I could just mash and that would be, for these early battles, okay, but later on in the game, that can be problematic. You kind of want to get, because the problem is that if your enemies fly too far away, your attacks will miss. They'll just outright swing at the air. You'll whiff. Oh, shoot. Now, a couple other mechanics that you're probably noticing. Whenever I get attacked, I can block. Now, the bar in the top right corner, that is my Idi bar, or Idi bar, I'm not sure exactly how to pronounce it, but that bar controls supers and blocking. I haven't used any supers yet, but I probably will right now, actually, because, yeah, so you need it to block, and Oh, right, this healing super. That was a mistake. You need it to block, but you also... You get it for attacking, you get it for blocking. And then when you... When you block, you, as you can see, you take some damage. You just take chip damage. It's not as bad as if you were hit directly, but it's still worth worrying about. Now, once you finish the fight, that bar will drain, and you'll heal up based on how much you have left. So, at this point, I think I'm actually going to want to heal up, but... Yeah, so the point is, essentially, you go through and you try to just attack. As you also might be able to tell, the combat system has a timing, has the active time set up similar to Chrono Trigger. Well, Chrono Trigger being one of the main influences on the devs in this regard. There are plenty of games that use active time battle system, but Chrono Trigger is the one usually cited, and it's also the one that I've played of these games that use active time battle. Which means you can get some you have to be kind of conservative. It pays to wait. It pays to wait until you have everything there. You get the most meter, you get the most attacks, you get to deal a lot of damage without the opponents being able to deal anything in return. But the downside is that you have to wait a little longer, which means you can get attacked. At this point, waiting is pretty much the best strategy. There's some harder boss fights where you don't necessarily want to wait. And if you start off and you don't hit them from the Metroidvania portion, if you go from the... If you just get touch them or you get hit, you actually will want to attack in order to get the meter to block. Otherwise, you'll be taking loads of damage. Also, someone pointed out, Finadol Pie is pointing in chat. Very nice graphics. Yes, it is. This is Lab Zero. This is Alex Ahad and Mariel Cartwright. They're both really good artists. If you saw any of the stuff I was doing for Skullgirls, or you saw Skullgirls at all, you know what they can do. This, however, as you can tell, is nowhere near the same tone or style as Skullgirls. In particular, the art style is considerably more subdued, you could say. I know a lot of people complain, not anyone who watched my cast, but a lot of people complain about Skullgirls and sexualization. Indivisible doesn't really have that. It doesn't have that element at all, which I'm sure for a lot of people will be quite nice, and it'll probably help with the game being more accessible, in a sense. People won't feel quite so embarrassed about playing it as they might about Skullgirls, even though, personally, I think Skullgirls is fine, but that's a different debate. But yes, this is Lab Zero. This is what they do. Now I have the axe. The axe is a nice little traversal tool. You use it to go up walls, as demonstrated here. And also cut vines, because that's why I could not get through those. I needed the axe to do this. I can switch back to the hand if I want to, if I want healing spells in combat, or want the slightly faster attacks. But axes, for the most part, they're the better option. At least for the prototype. They've seemed to be the better option. Hands, like I said, the super you get for hands is the healing super. It's the light healing super. You get a better healing super later on. For now, it's the only healing super I have. Axe is just damage. Straight damage if I do a super. And in some cases, will allow me to attack without getting attacked back. But this wasn't one of them. These ghosts are very difficult. They're just called apps. They're very difficult to deal with. Because they just deal a lot of damage. And also, they have really big hitboxes when you're trying to deal with them out of combat. So yeah, this is what Ajna does when I have an axe. Damage! And yeah, also, there was a lot of stuff, both engines... I mean, art-wise, not so much. It's just the artists are really good. Engine side, though, there are a lot of effects that were developed for Skullgirls. Like, the way that the supers work... Ah, crap. The way the supers look, the sprites... What is it called? Sort of like ghosting effects? That was added into... That's always actually been in Skullgirls, but the level of ghosting effect was something they added in for the PlayStation 4 version, which... I think I ported to PC version. But yeah, that is... A lot of this stuff is because the engine was something they'd already developed. They'd already produced a game with this engine, so it helps a lot. Now I'm messing up blocking, which is going to be a big problem later on. I'm not making this as efficient as possible. As I mentioned before, some of the attacks are area of effect. That was unwise. That hurts. I don't have my healer yet. I should get the healer as the next character, I think. Okay, good. Got rid of one of the Hungry Ghosts. That's what these are called, by the way. I think Tungar can hit them both with a super. Nope. But, it's not quite dead yet. Darn it, come on. There we go, and there's Razmi. Razmi is the healer. Okay. Get myself to an advantageous position. And with these large enemies, hitting them all at once is not as big of a concern, but they hit you all at once, so you need to be able to block. In case you're wondering, I'm using an arcade stick for this, because for these sorts of fights, I find it loads easier to use that than to try to mess around with a pad. Like where I'm getting hit with everything. Actually, this isn't the worst. There is a shortcut that allows you to block with everyone at once. But there are some enemies that will attack... Oh, shoot. That was poorly timed. There are some enemies that will attack, say, Ajna and Razmi, but they won't attack anyone else, and hitting that in a pad would be a pain. So I'd recommend Arcade Sticker Keyboard for this. It worked pretty well. You can play on a pad, no problem. It's just when you get that cross-block setup, it's much easier when you can hit the buttons independently. Alright. I'm going to try to be as efficient as possible when it comes to this game. I'm not going to be... I've played through this game a few times. Or the prototype, really. I mean, it's to the credit of the prototype. I played it through a few times. I'm still quite glad to play through it again. Just to see if I can optimize some stuff. Ah, okay, there we go. Want to get that hit in. There we go. Decent amount of opening damage. Decent amount of opening meter. Yeah, with the axe, the down attack launches. I'm still trying to figure out the best use of launching. And yeah, if it looks like I'm doing the same attacks, it's because I've kind of figured out some of the more efficient patterns. But this is also an easier section of the game. Later on, they'll be getting into some of the harder bosses. Like, there are some hard bosses that they threw into the prototype, and you have to be really careful about when you attack and who you attack with. Actually, even this is going to be... Oh, shoot, I used Rasmus one move. That was a mistake. I actually want to heal up pretty desperately. Chip damage is a real thing. Hold on. I attack with Ajna, and then... kill it too soon. I'm also not commentating too much on my decision-making right now, because it... Like I said, I have played through this a lot. It's kind of autopilot. For me? For me. I just do things in order, not... Like, the mindless way to do it would be this, which I'll show in a sec once Razmi stuff is... Actually, no, I'll just do it now. Be this. Which works okay, but not great. If I'm really not careful and I do things like Tungar's low into Ajna's attack, then I'll whiff, as I mentioned before. That's a distinct possibility, you gotta be careful about that. I'll just finish this thing off. Yeah, part of the decision-making largely involves a meter. Like, do you want to use meter for supers, use meter for blocking, do you want to use meter for... attack? Actually, I don't really care about breaking that. Do you want to use meter for... for later healing? Because when you finish when you finish every fight, you use that meter to heal. And that's where the axe comes in handy. I mean, other than just the exploration aspect of it. There's a monster down there I really don't want to deal with right now. That is one of the hardest monsters to fight. It's... well, rather one of the more tedious monsters to fight. So yeah, this part... I'm almost at the end of the prototype, actually, because we're about to get to the main game final boss. Well, the prototype final boss. This isn't it. This is, however, another rather annoying troll thing that he's dealing with. Yeah, by and large, I've kind of worked out where to start out. You have certain attacks do launch. Like, say, Tungra's attack will launch, and then I need to time everything else around that to make the most of it. Ah, shoot, didn't block it. Block too early. As you block, you drain meter. If you're out of meter, you simply cannot block. Alright, I should probably do my... Razz me slow. What the? Ah, oh, shoot. Gone in the muscle memory of doing... And I miss with Ajna. Gone in the muscle memory of doing super with Razmi. I forgot to not do the super sometimes. Oh, why'd I do that? I was gonna miss with Ajna. I did the low on Tungar and I missed with Ajna. The exact opposite of what I want to do. Now be slowed. Or I launch you in the air. Yeah, the ordering, like, for blocking, for example, like, this enemy isn't dealing me that much damage. If I was getting, say, 3,000 damage per hit, I'd want to be really careful about when to use the healing super. Right now, it's not as big of a deal, but... Yeah, it will be in a sec. Ow! Or not, well, not in a sec. I mean, the next boss is not going to be super difficult to work against. And yeah, if you're wondering about all the extra attacks and characters, that's because of Prototype. That is Prototype. And that's the A boss, the final boss of the main game. I can't remember what it's called, like Manote something? I can't remember. I'm afraid I can't remember the name. Manote was how it was being referred to on the board, so I'm gonna go with that. But yeah, I wanna use that healing early on, just so that I still have meter when I need to block, because this thing hits hard. Like, 1,000 points of chip damage. Anyway, the longer you do your combo, you get more meter for it. Ah, shoot. I was trying to be too perfect with the blocking there. I think if I get... Yeah, there it is. There's 2 meter. There we go. Let Razmi finish up getting her meter back. I'm gonna get slow. I'm gonna slow this thing, just to make it easier. It will eventually start summoning monsters, and that's when things start to get a bit interesting in this fight. Okay, 2 meter... Oh, this is the summoning monsters part. If I do this... To get rid of most of them. Okay. Stupid apps. I hate those things. Alright, that's... Oh, almost all of the side monsters. Almost all the side monsters. Good. See, that's where I want to limit use of attacks. Because if I... Attacks will miss if I'm being careless about how I use them. And I just screwed myself over. Other than that, a perfect block. Like I said, you need meter to block, and I'm not being careful enough with that. Get a slow going. I think that works a bit better if you're hitting it in the meantime. We'll give me another summoning of monsters pretty soon. For now, it's basically just deal the damage. This is a damage sponge boss. Kind of showing off how you can deal with larger things or how fights will vary over time. Not the most challenging thing in the world. So, don't worry if it doesn't seem to be too much of a challenge or putting up too much of a fight. There are things that will. That's super damaging because I haven't been hurt enough to really make me afraid of healing or feel like I need to heal. Oh, more summoning. And more of these guys. It's actually one thing that I've noticed in this fight that you want to do sometimes If I push this monster, push this monster back, say a couple times with Ajna, as I'm gonna try now, I can then start setting it up where all the monsters get hit at once because I was careful about how I set it up, killing the other. The other thing is Bula, I think, or hitting it much harder, not wasting shots. Okay, now I need to heal. That. And now it's just finishing this up. But like I said, this isn't entirely it. This is sort of it. We'll say it's it for now. Just we'll see if you want to. No, I'll get to it. Yeah, at this point it's just dealing damage until the thing goes down. Main reason you actually want to limit attacks is so that you're... I don't know how much it counts if you're in a combo or not. Like, how much of a difference it makes for it. I know you get more meter gain with a combo, but I'm not entirely sure how that ties into if it's in hits done or not. And yes, I can get out of the pit. It might take me a couple tries, but I can get out of the pit. Almost got all the meter. Okay. Come on. Ah, there we go. Okay, now it's... And that's the end of that boss. And that is the end of the main game of Indivisible, the prototype. I realized I went through it quickly because, like I said, I know what I'm doing. Oh, slow works on the next act. Thank you. That's going to be very useful in a moment. But anyway, for those of you who don't want to see the secrets, because there are some secrets, have a good night. Okay, for everyone else who does want to see the secrets, first need to get out of this pit. Pain in the butt, but doable. This takes me a couple tries. Ow, come on. This part's probably the hardest. This one section here, this one bloody ledge. There we go. Ah, what? That wasn't a problem before. I would recommend getting a glass of water or something. This sometimes can take me a little while. I'm not the... Ah. There we go. Darn it. There we go! Now... Shoot, didn't hold left far enough. Yeah, so if you're wondering, that speed boost is the reason why I care about getting in the pit, because that's how you get the secrets. You need that speed boost to get the... Oh, come on! Didn't hold right in time. What? This is gonna take me a little while, sorry. I was practicing earlier, or yesterday, and... Took me a couple tries, but yeah, it's... Come on. Like, after that boss is when the game actually starts to get legitimately difficult. But before that, I can... Ah! Keep pulling down. That's happening because I keep holding down. There's not like, a pixel issue or something. It's just I'm holding down the stick because this spring in the stick's kind of messed up. I don't know why it's taking me so many tries. I had this down to a science yesterday. If I can get to the other side, it becomes trivial. It's just this part requires a few tries. Especially since I'm screwing up which side I'm on. It that way. I want to go to the right. Swing to the right. Am I hitting the button too soon? Alright. I know I can do this too. I have done this several times before. And this has always been the... I keep screwing that part up. It'd be so bad if I didn't... If the stick wasn't broken, or... Well, the spring in the stick wasn't messed up and it wasn't hitting down when I thought it was centered. Because that's seriously what's happening. This spring in the stick is way too tight. Like, to the point that I actually have a negative dead zone, slightly. There we go. And this one, and... There we go. There we go! Got it! Alright, now this part's trivial. Well, almost trivial. If I fall from this, I'm gonna be extremely annoyed because I have never done that. And they pretty much set up the platform so you almost can't. Come on. And yes, the axe has a very satisfying sound. Lab Zero's animation and art department is matched only by their sound department. Oh, come on. The trick to this is actually kind of tricky. Basically, you have to tap to one side and then let go. So you get the right direction on the axe, but you don't actually get... And you also have to do it basically right as you leave the platform. There we go. All right, now I got it. Man, that took way too long. All right, took about, what, 6 tries, I think? There we go. So yeah, at this point, I can basically just run through enemies. And... So I'm going to go through the secrets in the order they were discovered. For a couple reasons. One is that in case you... Anyone... Most people probably know about the first secret, because the first secret was pretty much spoiled from the get-go. So in case anyone wants to save themselves and actually figure out the second secret, I'll give you the opportunity. Although I'm kind of hinting at it by the way I'm going for the first secret right now. First secret is just a platform. And then... Cerebella's Lock and Load Cat! Which, if you played Skullgirls, you know exactly what that is. Now, this is the thing I really wanted to show off. The rest of the game I was kind of doing just to show you because it's the game. It's a good game. It's pretty fun. It may not be much to watch, like, oh, I don't know how that's supposed to work, but especially when you're first getting into it, figuring out how to optimize the combat system is actually a pretty interesting challenge. But this is the part that I wanted to show you guys. So, there is a second secret. This is the first secret, trivial to find. But here's the thing, I want to go over my thought process to finding the second secret. It took me a while, but it occurred to me, this room might be a hint to the second secret, the way it's placed, what items are in it, and also, this ledge, I want to get on this ledge. I really want to get on this ledge. I can't. There's an invisible wall here. I cannot get on this ledge, but it's bugging me. And there's also these bricks here, and there's a cat face on the statue. Okay, and this area is blue. All these things, I was thinking, I gotta think about all these things. You gotta find an area, like, try to find where those bricks are. The first thing I was looking for were those bricks. Now, those bricks are actually pretty nearby. So I thought, okay, well, I'll find those. And I knew there were little ways in. But they're basically right... Well, there's some right here. There's also some down where I got the axe. And I thought, oh, well, maybe that's where they are, down this pit. And I thought, okay, well, there's these bricks right here. And it's blue, and there's a ledge. However, there are no statues down here. I'm not going to bother to show, but there aren't. There are no statues down here, and that's missing. And I thought, okay, well, let's try to find statues. Let's find where these... Because there's a few statues. You saw at the very beginning, or you might have seen at the very beginning. There are statues. Each temple has statues. I'm just going to go over the closer one, which is the second temple at this point. They have statues near the beginning. And those statues look kind of cat-like. And there's a little cat face on it. Okay, well, maybe it's one of those statues. So in that room, there was one of these statue assets, but it's kind of small. The thing is, that room, I kind of thought, maybe it's a microcosm. It's a smaller, just smaller. It's not really what I'm looking for. But here's the thing. There's another statue, which is much more obvious, that we passed by earlier. They didn't fight the enemies, but this statue right here. It's in blue. It's a cat statue. It has... Oh, get away. Now this is going to be a trivial fight. I can just mash. Oh, I can't, apparently can't just mash. Okay. But yeah, so I thought, okay, there's this statue, and I wasn't sure, because there's actually a, there, you can see there's a small texture error, which I've reported, that should be fixed. But I thought, okay, there's a statue there. Where would it be? It's not in that wall, because it's clearly a wall-damaging thing, but that wall has nothing special about it. But let's think about the other hint. The ledge. I thought, there's like this three-part ledge. I thought, well, I want to get on top of that. And then I looked at the wall and I noticed some of the bricks are kind of out of place. That's odd. Every other wall is pretty pristine, but this is the one that's out of place. Because that's the one you need to break through. And this is where the game gets hard. Now this cat at first is relatively easy. At first. But you'll notice something pretty quickly. It has more than one life. If you're at all up to English idioms, you'll know that it very likely, and in fact does, have 9 lives. Now we're on 2, 3, we're on 3. Now the first 3 or 4 lives are fairly trivial. It's the same sort of block and mash setup that I've been doing this entire time. For the first 3 or 4 lives. Once you get to life 5 or 6, then it becomes a bit more interesting. Then you have to start thinking. And also, it's actually a bit easier to use the hands for this, but axe is fine. So now we're on life 4. And now it's going to start to get a little bit tricky. Just a little bit. But remember, we're only halfway through. And bear in mind how much damage that was. That was 80 damage on Chip for like 10 shots. That was Chip damage. So this thing starts to get harder and harder. This is the hardest boss in the game, by the way. Not at first, but once it gets to life 6 or 7, this is the reason you actually want to care about the strategy of the battle system. Now we're on life 5. Still need to worry about healing too much, thankfully. Oh, wait, I wanted to do... Give me an attack in a moment. Fire. Now it's at 90. And... start ripping this thing apart. Slow it right down. That was bad. Do not want to say that's an okay damage to take attack to damage from for now, but it'll very soon be a problem. Whatever. You'll see why once we get to the 6th or 7th life. Oh yeah, and I've done this before, as you can tell. I have beaten this before, actually. And now we're on life 6. And this is where hell starts. That was 1,500 points of Chip damage. I feel it important to point that out. And I just realized I've screwed myself over because now Razmi has nothing to work with. Crap. That was actually a big mistake. This is where you don't want to use attacks. You actually want to save your attacks, especially Razmi's attacks, so that you can heal up on demand. Because that's going to be necessary pretty soon. Now it's fine, because Razmi will heal, well, recharge pretty quick. But yeah, that's going to be a bit of a problem if I'm not careful. And I'm not being careful. And now I don't want to use Razmi's attacks. If I use Razmi's attacks, I'm going to die. Because now we're on stage 7. Where it's going to be dealing like 110 damage for every one of those flame breath attacks on Chip. And it has... And there's a bunch of other attacks. That wave attack is going to be dealing close to 2,000 damage on Chip. Bites are now... Yeah, as you can see, it's a ridiculous amount of damage being dealt. Actually, that was also kind of a mistake. Get Razmi full up. And at this point, I'm actually doing okay, but that's partly because I have learned my lesson from the last time I fought this thing, which was don't be careless with your attacks. Shoot. And be on point with blocks. That's the problem, was the Razmi Ajna thing right there. That's actually been a bit of a problem for me in general, trying to avoid getting hit by that. Because if Razmi dies, like if Ajna dies, I have to start over. If Razmi dies, I'm in a really tight spot. Now we're on stage 8. I'm in a really tight spot if Razmi dies, because Razmi can revive. That hasn't come up yet, because I haven't actually lost anyone yet, but... Shoot, I forgot to block with Razmi. Now I've got to try to build as much meter as possible so I can get that healing going. Because Razmi's gonna die with... Crap! Okay, I'm dead. Great. I hope I didn't think I was good at this. Darn, I almost had a stage 8 too. I thought I was gonna take it. Screwed up that block. Like, you have to be on point with those blocks in this one. Now we're starting over. Stage 1. It took me 2 tries the first time, so... I was a bit surprised it actually took me one try this time. Just got messed up with a flame hitbox. And at this point I can go ham, so it's not really a big deal. Just go ham and then get to stage 4, so... I'm not doing supers, what the heck? Alright, stage 3, still pretty trivial. Oh, I should be using slow. Using slow a lot more. It's actually also a case where I want to use supers a lot more too, because I actually want to get... Not this stage, this stage is pretty trivial. But it is something you want to use eventually. Not just the healing super, because the healing super is okay, it keeps you alive. Now stage 4, I want to get to it. Want to get through, especially the last couple stages, as quickly as possible. Because at this point, I have not really taken much damage. At this point, so far. Okay, now I should be able to get through stage 4 without too much issue. There we go, and on to stage 5. That's a good idea. Laura Man suggests using heal only when necessary and using slow every time, just keeping an emergency heal for when it becomes necessary. That is a really good idea. I will do that. Seems like a good, as good a time as any to use heal. It may not be obvious, but I do not want to be in a situation where I do not have heal available to me. Oh wait, that was a terrible idea. I should not die yet, but it's going to be hard to avoid getting hit. Actually, I'm going to keep it at this stage for a little while. I'm going to need to keep it at this stage for a little while. Razmi needs to get back her healing. I think the timer restarts when it gets hit. And that's the emergency heal comes in. But this is still scary. If Ajna gets hit, it's going to be a lot of damage. It could be easily a 3,000 damage that would kill. Wait, aren't we on stage 6? Maybe we're on stage 7. I sort of lost count, actually. Now to avoid using Razmi for a little while. Because I need that... shoot. Need that stuff to recharge. I might need that emergency heal. Yeah, whenever you attack, you actually end up using part of the meter that was building. It goes down to about half of what you had. Oh no, we're on stage 7. Alright. We have heals in reserve, so just... There we go. I'm actually also not in the strongest position. I only have 2 attacks per character except for Ajna. Ajna's the only one that has 3 attacks per character, and that's kind of scary. Stage 8. Okay, that was a perfectly timed block. Oh, I didn't block? crap. And that's where Revive comes in.
Gross.
And that's why I need to have that emergency revive, emergency heal. Okay, that's 3 meter going. That's where the meter comes, like, that's where meter management comes in handy. You need to be on point with your meter management in this fight. Especially since I'm on stage 8 and now it's dealing 130 damage per shot with these. I think that's stage 8. Might be on stage 9, actually. Which would be nice, because that would mean I'm almost done this fight. But I think I'm on stage 8. And that was scary. Yep, that was stage 8. Now it's stage 9. Oh, man. We are not fine. Razmi's trying to be encouraging is not doing a good job. Oh boy, that's not good. Nope. Oh wait, that's Zebe. Oh wait, I wanted to do slow. Now it's just a matter of luck. Oh wait, no. Well, Razmi will heal up. No. Shoot. All right. This is bad, but I think it's still manageable. And to finish off with the super, but as long as Ajna doesn't die. Ah, it's not enough to kill. No, wait, no! Shoot! That's Zebe down. I don't want Zebe to die. I needed that meter to block. Damn it! Why does it take me 3 tries? It took me 2 tries the first time! I need to beat this for you guys. What the hell? Why can't I beat this? It's embarrassing. I mean, granted, the last time I did actually had 3 attacks per character, but still.
Right on target.
I want to grind some. That's... No, that's... That looks too easy. People aren't gonna... It's... No. I was just about able to do this with the attacks I have now. I just wasn't completely on point with everything, that's all. Got a stage 9, it's just screwed up at the very end. All right, there we go. Okay, I'm burning attacks apparently. Apparently that's a thing. You can just burn attacks. It's getting a habit using that slow. Hold on to that meter. I'm just gonna try to hold on to that meter as much as possible this time around. Ah, that was a waste of a slow. Darn it. Missing with Ajna a lot. That's bad. Glare you to death.
Nope.
Okay, so I made it to stage 5 or so without needing to heal yet. Or just about stage 5. Now we're stage 5. Okay, there we go. Made it to stage 5. Now we're at fire.
Get away.
Ah, shoot. And yes, I'm attacking at quickly because I need the heals. I don't want to get stuck in that heal vortex. Ah, darn it. Stay back. Wasting actions. There we go. I have more meter again. Not in a position where I'm at a risk of getting hit too hard, but we're still only at stage 5! Oh crap, and Tungra's taking a lot of damage. Okay, stage 6. Make sure I get the meter for this. Yeah, I'm getting to pocket heal pretty soon. And Razmi should be able to slow right now. Oh. Why don't you just slow? There we go. Yeah, as you can see, I'm still not perfect when it comes to knowing what's going to combo for me, so. There we go. Back to 3 meter. Good. Razmi once again is a pocket heal. Yeah, Razmi not having the third attack is actually probably the hardest thing about this fight. Whatever. But, I'm sure I can do it. I nearly did it last time, and we're on stage 7. Just need Razmi to heal up fully. There we go. Okay, decent amount of meter. I'm gonna burn up all my actions. Okay. Shoot, that wasn't the I need that pocket heal. That sucks. I'm gonna have pocket heal for a little while. Try to go with meter I can in the meantime, but yeah. Oh, that's stage 8 fire, isn't it? Yes, the amount of damage that stage 8 fire deals. I should be on stage 8.
Check this out.
Crap.
Walk it off.
Better give me enough time to get some meter back. Okay, good. Have some meter back. On to stage 9! Forget it last time. Oh, chipped out? Crap. That's bad. If I can get to 3 meter. Oh, I can get to 3 meter. That's not what I want to do exactly. Crap. Oh, phew. Okay. But yeah, this is where things get tricky, as I mentioned before.
Get away.
Yeah, it's the chip damage. Just the sheer amount of chip damage that's being dealt by this thing. Means that I'd be super careful how I position my or set up my attacks.
Right on target.
What am I doing? I need healing.
Get away. Get away.
Yes, I needed that healing. Zebe is the only one getting hit hard. Although, I actually could probably let him die. Yeah, that's not the biggest deal. In theory, it's a problem, but I'm much more concerned about Ajna and Razmi, and both of them are okay right now. What I need is meter. Ideally 3, but okay, I'm too much of a hurry to worry about 3 meter. Heal up. Get a 3 meter in a sec. If I can get a 3 meter, I can. I think I'm okay, actually. I mean, granted, Zebe is one of the best for gaining meter. But if I can stay alive. There we go. Zebe's back. Exactly what I needed. And I think this is it. Yep! Got it! Third time's the charm! Alright, let's finish this. So I've shown you guys everything. Actually, let's get through this section first. There we go. But yeah, I've shown you guys everything. So, now we're done. And that Tapiro is following around, is finally finding it. So yes, that is Indivisible's prototype. That is the entirety of Indivisible's prototype. I still recommend playing it, because the actual feel of playing it is different from the feel of watching it. But that is Indivisible's prototype. So I put the link for the Indiegogo page in the description. Well, it will be in the description on YouTube, but as you can see in the bottom as well. And you've seen the entire time. And yeah. So thanks for watching, and that's gonna be it for me tonight. That's my stream tonight. So thanks again for watching, and have a good night, everyone. And also thanks for the bits of strategy help. I'm still not an expert at this game. I've only played through it like 2 or 3 times. I've only fought that one boss once. That was the second time I fought it, and the first time I fought it, I was fully leveled up. I had all my attacks. So that was only like 3 for Ajna, 2 for everyone else, and Ajna's using the axe rather than the hands. Note that the hands are easier because you get the healing super, which I wasn't using. But that seemed to work anyway. I managed to get it in 3 tries, which isn't great, but not terrible. So yeah, oh yeah, also, Lawyer Man's pointing out that, yes, when the heal super, whenever you do a super, the first bar that fills up takes several seconds to fill up, and then after that it goes back to normal, which is why I was trying to avoid using another attack until Razmi was full up, so that I still have another bar when I needed it, because otherwise the red that's half from half charging, that ends up being half what it is. Like, say if it's 80% charge to the next attack and you use the first complete bar, you only have 40% charge now rather than 80%, and then it has to charge that. But because you just use a super and it hasn't gotten to the end of a super's recharge, it does the super recharge for the whole 60%, so it ends up taking far longer than it should. But yeah, thanks for watching, and have a good night, everyone. Oh yeah, don't forget, the Indiegogo thing. Throw money at it. Like, even if it's like 30 bucks, it's still, throw money at it, tell your friends, this game is pretty cool, play it yourself. Play it yourself, it's free, you can just play it yourself.